Okay, welcome everybody to the next webinar from the Students for Liberty, Liberty webinar series. Today we are here with Professor Steve Horwitz from Ball State University. Steve Horwitz is an American economist of the Austrian school and author of several books on Austrian economics. And the one that we are probably going to talk about most today is this one, Hayek's Modern Family, on the institution and the form and function of family and how it developed. And today we are probably going to talk mostly about the relationship of capitalism and the development of these functions and forms of the family. And before I pass it on to Professor Horwitz, just a few notes about how this is going to work. We hope that you will have a lot of questions. So if you do, please ask them in the YouTube chat. And we will get to them after the talk. And after we answer all the questions in the chat, we will send you a link to this call and we can end the stream and move on to a more informal debate. So with that said, I thank to Professor Horwitz for being here with us today and pass it on to him. Thank you again.
My pleasure. Thank you, Jan. Thank you all for coming out tonight. This is one of my favorite talks to give. It's a lot of fun for me. I hopefully it will be interesting and enjoyable for you as well. And it is, in fact, based on the Hayek's Modern Family book. It's really sort of about the first half of the book, which is really a history of the family and a history of the relationship between capitalism and the family. And you can see from my first slide, from my title slide, that I want to talk about how capitalism was responsible for a lot of the different features of the family that we know and love these days. And let me start by sort of laying out my argument, and then I'll back up and we'll walk our.
Sorry, there seemed to be some issue with the sound. Can you please try to say something?
How's that?
Yeah, no, it's fine. Thank you.
Okay. Yeah, that was my fault. Okay. So here's the argument. Okay. The first thing and the sort of fundamental issue I want to raise is an observation of Hayek's, that we live in two sorts of worlds at once, and what Hayek called the worlds of the intimate and anonymous orders. And I'll explain what I mean by that in just a moment. The second part of my argument is that before the emergence of capitalism, the family was not an especially nice place, particularly for women and for children. And we'll talk about why that is. What we now know and love as what we call the modern family is a product of capitalism. Let me be a little bit perhaps more precise there. It's not just capitalism. As you'll see, I'm going to talk a little bit about democracy and about other features of liberalism more generally. But I want to really focus on the capitalism part, on the economic factors that made it possible, that were responsible for these changes in the family. And one of the lessons I hope that I get across this evening is that the mutual freedom of markets and social life, that is, the fact that markets are relatively free under liberal capitalism, and the fact that we have all of these choices about how we can live our lives within the construct of the family, that mutual freedom, the fact that those two things happen together, they're related, and they're particularly important for us as we talk about classical liberalism, libertarianism, to understand that those two things go together. There's a positive dynamic between the freedom of the marketplace and those social freedoms. And one question that sort of sits across all of the talk this evening is how to navigate between these two worlds that I'm going to talk about in just a minute. How do we, there's a challenge for us that the modern order presents that Hayek observes and that I want to talk about as well. So that's the argument. So let's kind of back up and let's look at this difference between the intimate and anonymous orders. When we talk about intimate orders, we're talking about things like our families, but also our friend groups, our workplaces. These are the social organizations we exist in where we know people, we know them face to face, we know them well. And it's important to understand that these are the kinds of social groupings that we've lived in for our whole past, for most of our evolutionary past. Humanity, as we know it, sort of grew up in these sorts of worlds, in these intimate worlds. The world that we live in now, the anonymous world, which I'll again talk about more in a second, the anonymous world is peculiarly modern, the last few hundred years maybe. And our brains are such that we're used to existing within these intimate worlds. And these intimate worlds are characterized by unified ends, that is, everyone in that social group, that social organization, largely agrees on what the goals are, right? The easiest, if you know some economics, you think about a firm, right? You think about an economic firm, it has a unified end of profit seeking, profit maximization, okay? Or think about a sports team where the goal is to win, or an army to win a battle, win a war. So unified ends, and as a result, they tend to be characterized by altruism, by collectivism, and that's fine, right? Those are appropriate ways of dealing in those organizations to achieve those unified ends. I don't think we really want a family that's run like a market. We want families where parents make decisions in the best interest of their children, not just themselves, right? And we want people to recognize that the family as a collective has a particular set of goals and that people care about each other and should care about each other. We can contrast that with the anonymous orders, the market being the best example, and it's what Hayek and others call the great society, what Smith called commercial society, Adam Smith called commercial society. By contrast, these are organizations, orders that have diverse ends, that people within them pursue different goals. People act within their self-interest. They are individualistic and not collectivistic. And importantly, the anonymous orders tend to be run on the basis of rules rather than commands. That is, we obey certain rules, we obey certain processes, think about respecting property rights and contracts and so on that are at the foundation of the market. By playing by these rules, we're able to each pursue our own self-interest in ways that contribute to the best, to the welfare of everyone, right? This is, again, if you know some economics, this is sort of basic economics, and markets, again, are a good example of these sorts of anonymous orders. And as I suggested before, these are relatively recent phenomena, okay? That this is, again, the last few hundred years, and it's a challenge for us to learn how to live in these anonymous orders, okay? What capitalism did was turn a society made up largely of intimate orders into one in which those intimate orders were integrated into a larger anonymous one. If you think about what a liberal society is, it's a society in which we're part of a whole variety of these different little intimate orders and intimate societies, intimate organizations, yet they're all integrated by our interactions in the market. If you think about firms, right? You go to work, perhaps the firm is a fairly intimate organization, but it interacts with the rest of the world through the marketplace, the anonymity of the marketplace. And so it was capitalism that made that switch possible from a society that was almost exclusively made up of intimate organizations into one in which those existed in this larger anonymous order. And as Hayek pointed out, this poses a challenge for us. As he said, part of our present difficulty is that we must constantly adjust our lives, our thoughts, our emotions, in order to live simultaneously within different kinds of orders according to different rules. So we must learn to live in two sorts of worlds at once. So that is, we exist within families and firms and houses of worship and sports teams and all the rest, right? But we also exist within the world of the market or politics that are these larger anonymous orders. The rules of each are different. The expectations of behavior are different. How do we learn to exist in those different worlds at once? And that's the challenge. The challenge is, how do we learn to live in and navigate between these two different kinds of orders, but where each is essential to the functioning of modernity? We can't have only markets and only the liberal world. We need those intimate orders are part of it, right? But we can't just have them either, right? We can't turn the world into one giant family. One way to think about socialism and the problems of socialism is that the family in this sense can't be an encompassing institution. We need the larger anonymous order of the marketplace. So with that sort of concept in mind, okay, we want to look at the differences between what we might, what we'll call the modern and then the pre-modern family. And you might think I'm going to do this pre-modern, then modern sort of historical order, but I actually want to do it in the reverse. I want to talk about the modern family because we're sort of more familiar with that. We get that. And then we'll go back and see how the family differed from that historically. So let's first talk about the modern family. One way to think about the modern family is that it's made up of four different pieces or four different elements, okay? There's a modern family. One of which is that marriage is by choice and by love. And it's important to distinguish between choice and love here. Sometimes we run those together. We think of arranged marriages, and an arranged marriage normally is one that the parties have no choice and don't necessarily love each other either. And we think, oh, well, there's arranged marriages and then everything else is by choice and by love. But there's a third option here. People can get married by choice, but not for love. And in fact, for a good hunk of the history of the West, that's more or less how people got married. You could choose who you were marrying within certain limits, right? But it was, you didn't always marry them for love, at least not romantic love in the sense that we understand now. And we'll talk about why that is. But certainly today, what we think of as the modern family, marriage involves both choice and love. The family is today, the modern family is nuclear, that is, it's usually parents and children and their children. It's private and it's insulated. We think of families as being private space. A man's home is his castle. That idea has been used for some nefarious purposes too, but there's a truth there, right? A truth there that the family is protected, insulated from both the state, but also from the market in some sense too, right? We think of the family as being almost sheltered. I'm going to use that word again momentarily from these other broader social institutions. A third piece of the modern family is children. Children are sentimentalized, and childhood is most definitely sheltered. We think of children today as being sort of uniquely valuable, and we sentimentalize childhood and children. We treat them as absolutely precious resources. Sometimes one might argue too precious. We don't recognize that they're more resilient than we think they are. And childhood is sheltered. Kids spend the first 18, 22 years of their lives without the responsibilities of adulthood as we educate them and so on. We'll talk about how that came to be and why that's important. But we treat childhood as something distinct. Even the notion of adolescence is a fairly uniquely, a fairly recent phenomena, the idea of adolescence. And now we talk about late adolescence stretching into people's 20s and things like that. So the sheltered childhood is part of that modern family. And then finally, equality of the sexes and the idea that women have both rights equal to men, but also financial independence. And one of the consequences of that is that the modern family is subject to much more divorce than we ever saw historically. And again, this is something we'll talk about in more detail a little bit later on as well. So that's the modern family, okay? And we recognize that. That seems like the family that we're largely pretty much used to. Okay, then. What did the pre-modern family look like, and how did it become what we think of today as the modern family? So let's go back to the pre-modern family and sort of work our way back through some of these things, but talk about how the family before capitalism, one way to think about it, was different. Okay. First thing to understand is that for the vast majority of human history, the family was primarily an economic institution. One way to see this is that the household was the economic unit of production. The economies were founded, based in some sense, on households. Today, we think of the firm, of course, as being the unit of production. But for most of human history, it was the household. The easiest way to think about this is we think about agricultural families, farm families, right, where the household is not just the place where children are raised and so on, but also the place where production takes place, and then the household sells, consume some of their own, and then sells the rest to the marketplace. So households as the unit of production was a key part of the pre-modern family. And as a result, family members contributed to production. if you were part of that family, whether you were a wife, a husband, kids, extended family members, okay, all of you were expected in some way to contribute to the production of the household. Perhaps it was kids working in the fields. Perhaps it was mom or the grandparents taking care of the youngest kids. Whatever it was, everybody contributed. And one way to think about the family as a unit of production this way, right, is that you had, it was like a firm, and with the father, with the male head of household, as being the CEO for all intents and purposes. This was, again, as I said, mostly agricultural, but also small crafts. People produce things besides food. You can think of all the, you know, every movie you've ever seen of the olden days, and sort of cottage industries and sort of having a small craft work outside of your home. You can think about, you know, a blacksmith or something like that who would have been in this sort of trade. We know, one of the ways that we know that there was this link between the family and economic activity is, of course, last names. Right, many last names, certainly I'll use English examples, but many last names reflect the fact that those were what people did. Blacksmith, the one I just used, things like Cooper, who was a barrel maker, Fletcher, made arrows, Baker, Smith in general, right? So all of these, you can think of all kinds of names of people who were their last names reflected, again, who what they did. So, you know, if your name was John Baker, you were John the Baker. That's who you were, and that's what you did. It's also important to remember when we think about this time and this way of organizing things, that everybody, almost everybody anyway, was desperately poor. Okay, most people lived at the margins of survival. If you've seen Monty Python and the Holy Grail, and you know the scene where the king goes riding through and the peasants are working in the mud, and we get into that whole sort of political speech about it's an anarcho-syndicalist commune. If you know the movie and you know that scene, that's actually a fairly realistic portrayal of the difference between the king, the few who were king, and the many who were mucking about in the mud trying to scrape a living off the land. The Bring Out Your Dead scene about the Black Plague, also a fairly realistic portrayal of what life was like. So again, people were desperately poor, and that's important for some reasons we'll talk about in just a minute. But the family was not just an economic institution. It was also a political institution. For rich people, it was a path to political power. Who you married, if you were rich and powerful, mattered. Marriages were ways of consolidating power. You can think of lots of different Shakespeare plays that reflect this. And again, I go back to Monty Python and the Holy Grail, if you recall the marriage of Princess Lucy, and that whole scene where the her father refers to it, not means to say marriage, and refers to the merger of these two, and even after Sir Lancelot kills everybody, the marriage has to go on because, well, you know, he's got huge tracts of land. So all of this this idea that marriage was a political institution for the rich and a way of consolidating power is important. But even for poor folks, marriage had an important political function, which is it created broader networks of cooperation and community. When you married someone, you suddenly doubled your family. And one of the great things about grandchildren, of course, is now they've got two families who care about them. So in terms of expanding your ability to access resources at a time when people were poor, marriage and family creation was really, really important. So the family, sort of these instrumental purposes of the family were quite important historically. Well, so what else can we say about the pre-modern family? Well, one big contrast to the modern family, again, was that marriage was, for the pre-modern family, marriage was arranged, but even if it was chosen, it was not primarily about love. Remember, the key to a good marriage was the fact that the two of you were going to have to be able to produce together. Again, whether it was blacksmith or a farm, right? The nature of your partnership was such that it was about economic production. And that kind of came in two different ways. First of all, could you handle it, right? I mean, you know, today we think about finding a spouse by sort of, you know, the physical attractiveness of a spouse is about how are they good looking, are they this, are they that? But for at this time, right, the physical attractiveness was about, could you push a plow? Could you handle horses? Could you, and in the case of women, were you able to have kids? Because that was another key part of the story here, right? Was that having more children is, again, I'll get to that in more detail in a second, but having more children was important too. So why did people marry? People married because it was a good partnership, a good economic partnership. One way to think about it, again, if you know a little economics, is that for most of human history, what mattered was the complementarity of people's productive human capital. That is, how well did their ability to produce mesh with each other? When we think about marriage today, and we think about marriage for love today, it's about your human capital with respect to consumption. That is, does this person like the same things I like? Do they like to do the same things I like to do? What do they like to read? What do they like to eat? Do they like to ski? All of these kinds of questions are the important ones today. We don't tend to worry about whether we can be economic partners with each other when we get married. And that's a key change, key difference from the pre-modern family. Another big difference, of course, is women, the status of women. Women, for again, most of human history were almost property. What we know as now coverture laws essentially gave husbands the right, their rights covered those of their wives. Men were the decision makers for the entire family, the entire household. Married women were very limited in what they were able to do economically. They couldn't make contracts on their own. Even until the 1960s, that's the 1960s, married women frequently in some states in the United States couldn't open a bank account or get a credit card without permission of their husbands. So this, you know, the status of women historically were essentially property. And kids, of course, were economic assets. The more kids you had, the more labor you had on the farm. Okay. And in addition to labor on the farm, kids provided old age support. So one measure of your wealth, right, was how many kids would you have? And it's certainly cheaper and more fun to make kids yourself than it is to try to hire people to work on your farm. So having more kids was good. The problem, of course, was that child mortality was incredibly high. About half of children who were born did not make it to age 18, and it was not unusual to find families with two or three children with the same first name, as parents would use the same first name multiple times, knowing that odds were that anyway, that only one of those would make it to adulthood and carry on the name. And this meant for women, of course, that women wives were almost constantly pregnant or nursing. It was very difficult life where that was the case, and still expected, of course, to manage the household and help out on the farm or in the craft or whatever it might be. So this was not a particularly good world for women. And one way to see here is you can see how pre-modern families were less able to afford to be sentimental about children, right? We're extremely sentimental today about kids, but imagine a world in which odds were that half your children would die before they were 18, right? To sort of pour your sentimentality out on them and literally not to have the resources to do it, right, was going to be a problem. You had to be a little bit more stiff upper lip about children and about their odds of survival. It's also important to recognize that families at the time were much more public institutions. The church, the state, the community all had a concern and all regulated family behavior from sexuality to who you could marry and in all kinds of different ways. And in particular, remember too, right, that the economic stakes were high. If you married the wrong person and you couldn't produce together, you were a threat not just to your own survival, but to the survival of the whole community. Okay, if you couldn't pull your weight economically, so the community had a really big stake, especially your own extended family had a really big stake in who you married and why and whether it was a good match. Of course, what hasn't changed, right? What hasn't changed is that families were and are and always likely will be indispensable as a transmitter of cultural norms and values. It's where children learn how to be human, how to operate within the modern world, how to operate within the world around them. Families, parents, but not just parents, play key roles in making that happen. And it's important because I'm going to, as we go along this evening, make a few arguments that, you know, suggest that that the so-called traditional family isn't the only kind that works. And don't get me wrong, I think families are awesome and that marriage is awesome, right? Because we need these, we need them as these transmitters of cultural norms and values. Okay, so that's the modern and the pre-modern family, all right? And just to drive home this point, I don't know how well you can see the slide on screen. This is from a cemetery in New Orleans, Louisiana. This is seven children, and then an eighth from a separate marriage, but seven Claveri children, all of whom died, if you notice, at no later than 7 years old. That's, you know, we can't even imagine that today, but that was the reality of life. In the 19th, this was in the 1800s or late 1700s. This was the reality of life before the 20th century, really. And an interesting day to think about this as we celebrate the invention and distribution of an amazing vaccine that was developed in record time. So you now ask, all right, Steve, what did capitalism do? How did capitalism play into these changes that we're talking about? Really, two, maybe three ways. But the most important two, first of all, is wage labor. One of the key things that capitalism does is it brings the factory system into widespread use. And those factories hire, for the first time in human history in an extensive way, hire non-family, right? So when you went to work, okay, you were working with people who were not members of your family. And so for the first time really in human history, for an increasing number of people, we separated home and work in a fundamental way. Notice, right, with our pre-modern family, there was no going to work. You worked and lived in the same place. And I'll just note the sort of irony now many of us are working from home in ways that we didn't expect to as a result of the pandemic. We have once again put work and home back together in some interesting, though importantly different ways. We can certainly, that's something if you want to talk about during the Q&A, we can certainly talk about it. But capitalism separated home and work in this way. And it in doing that, right, it took away the family's role as the key unit of economic activity, of economic production. And the family slowly began to shift to a unit of consumption, which is how we think about it today, right? And we think about, when I think of, say, you know, sort of think about your family, think about the house you grew up in, right? Most of the things in your house today are things that are about consumption. We talked about how marriage is about complementarities and consumption, but certainly what households do, and when we analyze households in economics, we analyze them as units of consumption. It's the firm that's the unit of production. And that separation, right, is part of the changes that capitalism brought with it. And as we'll see in a minute, that had some important implications for how families operated. The other key piece, of course, is that capitalism led to an increase in wages and an increase in wealth. Okay, as workers began to work with better and better machinery, better and better capital, they became more productive. Their wages went up. The wealth that families had increased. This had a number of important effects. One of them is that family size shrunk. You no longer needed all the kids to work the farm, right? Early in the Industrial Revolution, of course, many, many kids worked in the factories. But what we saw happen as wages and wealth continued to rise, the children came home from the factories, and then women who had been working in the factories also came home from the factories as well. But certainly early on, right, it was all hands on deck as families who were working in the people who worked within factories needed all of that income to survive. So let me just say a couple things about these two bullet points. First of all, family size shrinks, right? So parents begin to have fewer and fewer children. They do so not because we were distributing birth control or anything like that, but they rationally recognize that they didn't need to have as many kids. And with additional wealth, they could invest more in the kids that they had. They could have fewer and better kids, if you want to think about it that way. I'm going to come back to that point in just a second. But it's also the case, again, that they were able to invest in kids because kids were coming home from the factories, no longer working in the factories. We can talk more, if you'd like, about child labor. I'll just make a couple of points here. First of all, child labor was on the decline well before the laws prohibiting it were passed. So oftentimes you'll hear people say, well, you know, if we didn't have laws against child labor, we have five-year-olds working in the factory. Well, no, actually, we wouldn't. Really wasn't too many, if any, five-year-olds working in the factory ever. It was kids who were older than that. But in the cases where kids were working in the factory, it was because that income mattered. That income, the margin of that income was important to those families to survive, okay? And they needed that additional income from children. And as soon as wages began to rise, thanks to capitalism, families were quick to get their kids out of the factories where they could, and they were already coming home well before the laws took effect. It's also important to recognize that capitalism didn't invent child labor. Kids worked for all of human history. They worked on the farm. They worked outdoors in terrible conditions for 14 hours a day. For as awful as conditions in factories were, they were still better, right? At least you were indoors. Hours were shorter than out on the farm, and the work was less brutal than it often was on the farm. What capitalism did was make child labor somewhat more visible and then helped end it by raising wages to the point where children no longer needed to work. Marriage becomes about love. When the household is no longer the key unit of production, when it doesn't matter as much for production purposes who you marry, you can afford to indulge yourself in love. For love was always there, okay? People always loved each other, but sort of marrying for love really doesn't happen until the last couple of hundred years when, again, more and more people, in essence, could afford to do it, where their marriage decision wasn't so fraught with economic danger if they made the wrong decision. And so we see, starting with the upper class and then working its way through the middle class and down, marriage becomes increasingly about love. And as I've suggested, childhood changes too. Rather than kids working the farm or the factory, they're at home, they're being educated, that sheltered childhood that we talk about and that sentimental childhood that we talk about all become part of the picture here. This is our images of the Victorian family of the late 19th century, right? This is where it all originates. This is in the changes that capitalism brought about. And finally, the family becomes private. The state, the church, and the community are all restrained. And again, certainly democracy and liberalism more generally have a lot to do with this, the separation of church and state, the limits on state power, but also the community is pushed back as people, adults, establish their claim to decide who they want to marry and how they want to structure their lives, and the community plays an increasingly smaller role in those decisions. Again, as I said, democracy and liberalism play roles here in addition to capitalism more narrowly. So that's the changes in capitalism. That's how capitalism is the key mechanism here for this change. And I want to focus for a moment on the role of women in particular, because this the changing role of women in the last 100, 150, but certainly last 100 to 125 years has been enormous. And probably there was no bigger social change in the 20th century than these changes in the roles of facing women. Again, I don't know how well you can see that, but this is a picture from a 1930s or 40s with a bunch of women at adding machines women who were working. That's important to understand. What's interesting, of course, is that these jobs no longer exist. They've been replaced by, you know, a cell phone in your hand or a desktop computer. The part I want to make here is that one of the things we saw over the course of the 20th century and that that capitalism was importantly responsible for was a growth in female labor force participation. More and more women over the course of the 20th century became involved in paid labor. There's a story out there, right, that goes something like this, that says, and it's often put forth by conservatives, a story that says women in the 20th century, they didn't work outside the home. They didn't work outside the home. And then came the 1960s and women's liberation, and suddenly all these women started working and everything went terrible from then. Now, aside from the fact that things didn't go terrible from them, the rest of the story isn't true either, right? The changing role of women, the increase in female labor force participation was much more gradual than that. It grew steadily over the 20th century. There was a notable increase in the 60s and early 70s, mostly due to women with very young children entering the labor force in greater numbers as childcare options became greater. So that's important, I think, to keep in mind here too. But the question of why do we see this? Why do we see more women working? Two reasons with a third consequence. One is that the economy grew, and as the demand for labor rose, firms needed more workers, and one way to get more workers was to hire more women. At the same time, women were increasing their human capital. They were getting more educated, they were getting more experience, more skills. The combination of a higher demand for their services and then more productivity meant that the wages they could get were much higher than they used to be. And so with those higher wages, more women were drawn out of the household. One way to think about it, the economics of it is it raised their opportunity costs of staying home, of not working, because they could earn more in the marketplace than they could previously. Okay. So that helps explain it. Another thing that helps explain it was a decline in the time that was needed at home thanks to household technology. So the obvious stuff here, right, things like washing machines and dishwashers and vacuum cleaners and so forth, all of which, and modern stoves and refrigerators, all of which made keeping a house much easier than it used to be. Keep in mind, too, they had fewer children than they used to. With the declining number of children, this also means that women could space out their pregnancies better. We had somewhat better birth control technology, though not great. And all those things made it possible for women, to married women in particular, to make decisions that enabled them to work outside the home in growing numbers compared to previously. Finally, increasing wealth means that people could afford market alternatives to household labor. So this is becomes a little bit more powerful later on in the 20th century, but think of it this way. Think about how many times when you guys were, say, in high school that you went out to dinner or brought dinner home had food you paid for dinner in an average week. I'm betting it was probably a few times. If you ask your parents or your grandparents that question, you'll find it was probably something like once or twice a month at most. Certainly your grandparents once a month at most. We spend much more money now purchasing food to go these days or eating out than we used to. But you can also think about things here like dry cleaners or paying people to clean your house or mow your lawn or whatever it might be. Right, all the things that we used to do ourselves, we can now afford to pay someone else to do. Notice too that a lot of those things that we pay for are jobs that are occupied by the very women who are working, right? And so we have women working in jobs where we're paying them to do the things that we used to not pay either housewives or house husbands to do. And that gain in specialization in the division of labor and wealth is a sign of progress. And it has given women the ability to earn independent incomes and be financially independent. Importantly, as I said, all of this predates the 1960s. One way to see this is that the feminist movement was more a result of these changes that took place during the 20th century, not a cause, right? if you've watched Mad Men, you know this. The work environment for women in the 40s and 50s was awful, right? Women worked, but it was a terrible place to be, and they were subjected to all kinds of sexism and abuse. And you can see why that would get them upset enough and sort of bring forth the feminist movement, which was more, again, a result, not a cause of women working. And then finally, the thing that really did matter, as I suggested earlier, is the pill. The birth control pill, the female birth control pill, gave women control over their bodies and over their fertility for the first time, right, without having to depend upon men. And this enabled them to plan out their lives in a very different way, to make much more intentional decisions about work, about marriage, and all the rest. And this was key, certainly in the last 60 years, to the rise of women and women's increasing economic equality. So I'm going to go for another 10 minutes, I think, at most. And so let me talk a little bit more about family in the 20th century and then family in the 21st century. So as I've suggested, capitalism's wealth led to two key trends in the 20th century. One, women's financial independence through labor force participation rates and higher wages. And that meant a decline in the benefits of specialization by gender. What do we mean by that? Well, for most of human history, right, it was largely the case that men earned incomes in the market and women produced in the household, engaged in household production. And so you could see how heterosexual marriage sort of made sense. It was economists like this. It was specialization. It was trade, right? It was cooperation. By partnering, they could benefit from each other. Women could get a source of income. Men could get a household taken care of. But that was premised on their human capital structures looking very different, right? Being specialized. But now men and women's human capital structures look very similar. In fact, women earn more college degrees in the United States than men do right now. So as they became, as men and women's human capital became more similar, the benefits of specializing by gender became fewer. And as a result, the marriage offers fewer material benefits, right? You don't get the sort of gains from exchange in that sense of specialization and trade aren't there anymore for marriage. And you can expect that one of the results of this is that people tend to marry later and less often because, again, it does not have the material benefits. What marriage does have, though, what has happened is that marriage has a much more, much larger emotional and psychological role in people's lives, right? The reason people marry and the benefits that come from marriage are about love and companionship and partnership and all of the things that we think about that we now, associate with marriage. And one way to think about this is that what capitalism did is to come in and take the economics out of the household, out of marriage, and push it out to the marketplace. And it opened up this space for marriage and family and the household to be mostly about love. What's interesting, of course, is that, we like that, and that's great, right? And it's wonderful, we praise it. But it also has an irony attached to it. One of the ironies attached to it is that it also helps us to understand the increase in divorce rates, right? And there's two ways to see that. It's a combination of, in the language of economists, of both preferences and constraints. So let me do the constraints part, right? That's the obvious, okay? Women have much more financial independence, have much more leverage than they used to. Women don't have to put up with terrible marriages. It is more likely, easier for them to get out of a bad marriage. And so it's reduced men's power within marriages. And as a result of having fewer constraints, of having more economic independence, we see more women who are willing to get out of marriages, and we see more divorces. But the preference thing matters here too, right? Because if the standard now is a happy marriage is a marriage that's about this sort of really deep notion of love, in a way, we've raised the bar for what a happy marriage is. Historically, right, you weren't expected to be sort of goofy in love with the person you married. I mean, you love them, you grew to love them, but that love was the love of a partnership, of a life lived together, of children raised, and so on. Now we expect so much emotionally out of marriage that when marriages fall short, it's somewhat easier for people to say, I'm unhappy, this isn't working for me, I want out, right? And so the fact that marriage is now about love in the ways that it is has raised our expectations of what marriage should be, and more marriages fall short. So between that sort of change in preferences and that change in constraints, okay, we see this increase in divorce rates. And I want to note, right, that this is this increase in divorce rates is was inevitable, I think, as a result of these changes. And I think it's mostly irreversible. What we are seeing right now is a slight decline in divorce rates. And what seems to be the case is that we're seeing fewer but better marriages. People are getting married later and less often. But when they do get married, they seem to be better matches. And I think there's some interesting reasons for that we can, again, we can talk about that in the Q&A. Okay. So what about family in the 21st century? Clearly, the last 20 years, the sort of major family-oriented change has been the demand for legalized same-sex marriage. And what I want to argue is that this is part of this same long-run trend that we've been talking about here, right? How did capitalism, liberalism more broadly, and its wealth help produce this demand and eventually this legalization of same-sex marriage? I'm going to list off a few things here and sort of talk about each of them quickly. First of all, what capitalism enabled us to do was to survive economically outside of the family, outside of the household, right? For again, most of human history, you had to be in a household to survive economically, to be able to work the land or to run a small cottage industry. But factory work and the rest of the marketplace enabled you to leave your family and survive on your own without it in important ways, to survive as a single person, but to survive just even as outside the heterosexual family. The growth of cities was important here too, right? As wealth increased, as capitalism increased wealth, we see more cities. Cities makes it possible to live anonymously, that is to live as a gay or lesbian person in ways that at a time when that was a problem, enabled you to do so anonymously and enabled the development of those communities. If you think about where gay and lesbian communities developed, it's in big cities and usually in cities, port cities, where there was lots of people coming in and out, changes of ideas and lots of people who you didn't necessarily know very well. It made it possible to live the kind of life that you wanted. Certainly liberalism had a broader ethos, quoting Leonard Reed, of anything that's peaceful. The 20th century changes in civil rights and in acceptance of all kinds of consensual activities certainly made homosexuality less of a problem and homosexual sex more accepted as being okay among consenting adults. And the separation of sex, marriage, and kids. Again, our discussion of the pill just a moment ago is part of this too, right? In the 20th, before the 20th century, the assumption was you got married and only then could you have sex, and then sex would produce children. But today there's no order anymore, right? You don't need marriage to have sex. You can have sex without having kids. You can be married and not have kids, right? All the possibilities are there, even within the context of heterosexual relationships. And once all those were seen as okay there, right, you can see why gay and lesbian couples might say, well, wait a second, right? Why are we any different? Okay. And certainly the change in marriage from economics to love. Once marriage became about love, it was even more clear for gay and lesbian couples to say, wait a second, we love each other too. Why are we any different from you? And why aren't we entitled to the same rights? And so the demand and eventual acceptance of same-sex marriage was a result of this combination of things. And one way to think about this is that the real revolutionary change in marriage and the family was when capitalism made marriage about love. Same-sex marriage is not as revolutionary as particularly its critics want to point out. It's sort of the next evolutionary step. Once you make marriage about love, and once these other things happen, right, it's not hard to imagine why same-sex marriage would be would be seen as the next step. And once again, right, families and marriage are important. Western civilization needs it. But the question for the 21st century is whether multiple forms, multiple family structures are able to do the job. What we've seen happen over the course of the last couple hundred years, and certainly in the last 50 to 100 years, is that there's no longer any particular form of the family that's majority, any particular structure. I mean, families, as you've seen, have changed historically over time. But right now, right, there's all kinds of different families that people form, all kinds of different ways that people get married, and maybe more coming, right? And the question for now is, can all of those things do the job effectively? Are they all good enough, right, to get the job done, to raise children, to bring them into the world, to socialize them, and so on? Right, we have everything from same-sex couples to heterosexual couples to single parents to extended families to all the grandparents caring for small children, all the things that we have, right? They're all options in a way they didn't used to be, and that's great. And the question that we need to tackle is, do they all work well enough? And I think the answer is yes, but I think that's also the question. So my final thought, there's my buddy Freddie Hayek. Those glasses are now back in style. That's the cool thing from this picture from the 1970s or 80s. Hayek wrote, in Why I'm Not a Conservative, the liberal position is based on a courage and confidence, a preparedness to let change run its course, even if we cannot predict where it will lead. And I think that's one way to see the argument I've made this evening, which is by outsourcing the family's economic functions to the anonymous world of the market, capitalism caused the family's intimacy to evolve from a repressive patriarchy into a loving and far more equal institution. We don't know for sure where this is going to go next. We never do. But if we think that, if we have confidence in freedom, if we have confidence in humans' ability to adapt and change, as we've seen historically, we should feel pretty confident that we'll figure this stuff out and that we'll see all kinds of perhaps new ways of organizing the family, but all of which will have to solve the same problems that we've always solved. I think the challenge is, however, can we live to learn to live in these two sorts of worlds at once? Can we recognize that the way families operate is different from the way that markets and the extended order operate? Certainly in the time we're in right now, where increasing number of calls for socialism or forms of authoritarianism, all of which seem to sort of want to bring people back to a, for lack of a better term, a nationwide family, are problematic. And Hayek said, if we try to do that, it's impossible. We'll destroy the social order. Can we get people to understand that you can't do that, right? That you have to learn to submit to the discipline of rules, to use another Hayek phrase, in that extended anonymous order, even though we spend so much of our lives in the intimate order of the family and the firm, that we're so used to operating in those worlds. Can people learn to differentiate between the intimate and the anonymous in those ways? And with that, I thank you.
Thank you, too, for a great talk. So again, we will now take questions. So if you have any, you can type them to chat and we will read them out. And afterwards, after we take a few questions, we will send you the link for this call. You can join us and we can start a more informal debate or chat. And before we go to the questions or before you think of some, just a reminder that if you want to read more about this topic from Professor Horwitz, you can still buy his book. I believe there is now a discount on Palgrave, so you can get it for $20, I think.
Yeah, I think it's still good. So you might have to poke around a bit there. Go to the sale page and then try to search for the book. I think that's the best way to do it.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So far we have just one question from Jan Oravec, and he asks if you could explain in more details the concept of sentimentality to non-English speakers.
Oh, sure. The best way to this, we worry about our children. We protect them from every bad possible thing that could happen to them. This is a bigger problem, I think, in the United States right now. If some of you may know Lenore Skenazy's book, Free Range Kids, that's a good book that's the opposite of that sentimentality. So the sentimentality is that we think, we tend to think about kids with our hearts first, and we worry about them taking any kind of risk. We treat childhood as this very sort of precious time in which it's Christmas time, right? It's the most sentimental time of year. So it's that we treat it very emotionally, and that we put kids on this kind of emotional pedestal where what we're always thinking about is how happy does something make them, how sad does it make them, you can think about if you watch The Simpsons and you know the Reverend Lovejoy's wife's character is always popping up to say, and what about the children, every time they talk about an issue. That's part of that sentimentality always thinking that we have to protect the children from everything kind of attitude. Does that help?
I hope so. We certainly don't have any more questions from Jan, but we have another one from Martin, who asks or who comments that he hasn't seen any data on this, but it seems possible to him that some parents are overly quick to end marriages to the detriment of the children. So do you think this is the case, or maybe not to be so quick?
Yes. Yeah, say the first part again. My poor dog is making noise.
Yeah. He says that he hasn't seen any data on this, okay, but it seems possible to him that some parents are overly quick to end marriages to the detriment of the children.
Yeah.
So you have seen the data on this, and if this can be sort of improved in a way.
Right. So I think here's what we know about divorce and children. The children of divorce tend to do a little bit worse on average on sort of psychological measures than kids from intact marriages. So, okay, stop there, right? Three things to consider when we think about that. First of all, the differences are very small and the distributions highly overlap, right? So what this does not mean, of course, is that every kid from every divorce is going to be worse than every kid from every intact marriage. Okay, it just means on average, there's a little bit of difference between the two. Second, it seems to be the case that the explanation for this is that what really harms kids is conflict in their parents' relationship. So kids who are the children of low conflict divorces tend to be just fine. And kids who live in high conflict marriages tend to be worse off. So when we switch the question from are you married, are the parents married or divorced, to is there a lot of conflict in the house versus is there not a lot of conflict in the house, what we learn is that low conflict homes, whether married or divorced, kids do better. So one implication of that is that if you're in a high conflict marriage, your kids may be better off if you divorce and can do it in a way that gets that conflict out of the house. So it's a little more complicated than just married or divorced. Finally, sort of a little different point here. I think you have to consider the well-being of kids when you talk about divorce. It can't be everything. Otherwise, you're doing the sentimentalization of kids thing, right? You do have to take into account the interests of the parents, right? I mean, if you are, say, a woman in a marriage that is in which you are being emotionally abused, for example, getting out of that marriage is the best thing you can do for you. It probably will benefit your kids if you're in better psychological shape than in that marriage. But the parents, to put it in economics, the parents' utility counts too, right? We can't just judge whether divorce is good or bad based on the impact on kids, although it is really important, and they are usually innocent third parties. But the parents matter too. So I think when we talk about divorce, I think we got to think about all of those things, right? Divorce is evidence of a failure of some kind, right? The failure of a plan. Sometimes that's a good thing if it was a bad plan. Sometimes it's not. And I think it's probably a good thing right now that we're seeing fewer but better marriages. And maybe that means fewer divorces and fewer impacts on kids. But I think when we think about divorce and children, we got to consider all three of those things that I mentioned.
Okay, thank you for the answer. So I think we can now invite people here and start a more informal debate. So I'm sending the link for this call in the comments for the YouTube video. So through the link, you can access this call. So join us. We will soon end the stream so that you can ask your questions of the record if you don't want to be recorded asking, or you can just there's also chat here, so you can ask in the chat here, and we look forward to further questions, and we also say goodbye to the stream viewers.
So
thank you again to Professor Horwitz for taking the time, and we will see you at further events after Christmas, so also enjoy Christmas. Okay, so I send the link.